So what was the discussion we left off in the previous lecture was we were trying to analyze bipolar junction transistor circuits intuitively. And I said to understand or analyze bipolar junction transistor circuits intuitively, you have to understand few building blocks. Most BJT circuits, any complex bipolar junction transistor circuit will be, if you try to subdivide it, you can just divide it into, in its simplest terms, you can divide it into one of these configurations that we have discussed so far. Okay, so if you know how to analyze output resistances, input resistances, and voltage gains for the single stage amplifiers, okay, in a more detailed and an exhaustive manner, you should be able to analyze any complex bipolar junction transistor circuit. So the whole idea of microelectronic circuits is that as the course structure goes, the first course here mainly discusses with the analysis part. We introduce you to the different ideas in circuit design, and we also teach you intuitively how to analyze circuits. Okay, so that I again told you don't have to resort to a rigorous Kirchhoff's current laws or voltage law analysis while analyzing these circuits. Next semester, when we teach an advanced, I mean rather that's analog integrated circuit design course, in that course, we will be teaching you slightly more complex circuits called operational amplifiers and a few other analog circuits. So those circuits, to understand those circuits, you need to have an intuitive understanding of circuits. Okay, so the basics, the intuitive understanding of bipolar junction single stage amplifiers and differential amplifiers, which we'll teach at a later stage. Okay, so that's very essential. That's the goal of this course. So what we are discussing in the past few lectures is how to analyze bipolar junction transistor circuits intuitively. And I said that to do that, you may have to remember a few results. Okay, so just to quickly refresh your memory, we discussed three results in the last class. What I have written here is resistance looking into the collector terminal. So we said there are three terminals of a bipolar junction transistor. It has three terminals. So we will look into one of those terminals and try to compute the resistance or impedance you see with respect to that terminal and ground. Okay, I said usually when you generally your resistor is a two-terminal element. So, but in analog design or rather in microelectronic circuits, when I refer to resistance seen at a given node, I'm automatically implying that node and an AC ground. It's automatically implied between these two is what we are trying to define it. So in the last class, we discussed an interesting result. We said that if you look into the collector of a BJT with a resistance RE at the emitter, we said the output resistance can be written as R0, the R0 of this BJT, R0 of this BJT, plus RE parallel R pi. So you have a resistance R pi here. You have to put that, I mean, you have to take that R pi in parallel with RE. And there is a third term, which is GM R0 into RE parallel, I mean, RE parallel R pi multiplied with GM R0. Okay, so this is the important term, which I'll give you an intuitive understanding for this as well, probably at a little later stage. I'll try to give you an intuitive understanding. But because very soon we will be starting to discuss MOSFET circuits composed of MOSFETs. So the intuitions are similar. Okay, the only difference between MOSFET and BJT as far as analysis goes is R pi. The only difference is R pi is infinity for MOSFETs. Otherwise, the analysis is exactly similar and beta is infinity. R pi is infinity. So in fact, beta tends to infinity for a MOSFET. So therefore, R pi, which is actually beta by GM, will also tend to infinity. So if you use these two conditions, whatever we have derived so far for BJTs, I mean, the same things will apply for MOSFETs as well. In fact, MOSFET analysis is much simpler than a BJT analysis. So this is one expression we derived. Okay, and the second expression that we derived, two expressions that we derived was one of the cases is we were looking into the base and we terminated the resistance to the emitter with the resistance RE. And we said the resistance seen at this point at the base are in B. I'll write it as a resistance seen at the base terminal is actually R pi plus RE into beta plus 1. And here I said this is if you ignore R naught, if you actually consider R naught. If you consider R naught, then this result will be R pi plus. The only difference is R naught is in parallel with RE. Both these resistors are in parallel. They both will come in parallel, and you have the expression that looks like this. R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE parallel R naught. So that we said. Now just think intuitively, what is RE doing to the circuit? The presence of RE, is it increasing your input resistance or decreasing the input resistance? I mean, it's very trivial. I'm just asking it because you're learning for the first time. No, the presence of RE, is it increasing input resistance, RN? Is it increasing RN or decreasing RN? Let's assume RE is zero. There was no RE. If there was no RE, yeah, it is increasing. If there was no RE, then the input resistance was just R pi. Right? The input resistance looking into the base was just R pi. Now the presence of RE, if you see there is an additional term because of RE, you get input resistance much greater than R pi. It will actually be greater than R pi. It depends on the value of RE, but it will be greater than R pi. So that's something that's something that you have to keep in mind here. So now let me ask you this question. If you recall from one of the previous lectures, we said, let's say we have three transistors like this, and I have the collector is an AC ground, and I'm looking into the base of the first transistor. Okay, so what will be the result? First, ignore R naught. Let's assume R naught is infinity. So what will be the input resistance at seen at this point? So we said this input resistance seen here is R pi. What is the input resistance seen here at this point? See, this is R pi here. So if I replace that with, yes, it is. It is R pi plus beta plus 1 into R pi, right? So that's what we discussed. So whatever resistance is here, that multiplied by beta plus 1, you get it here. So you get beta plus 1 into R pi. Plus R pi. I can assume that's very small compared to beta. I'll assume it's close to beta itself, or beta R pi itself. So therefore, at this point, what will be the input resistance at this point? Can you approximately say it will be beta plus 1 whole square into R pi? Can I say that? Approximately. Yeah, because you know, there are some more terms as well, R pi as well, but I'll say approximately beta plus 1 whole square. So what is this telling you is that if an engineer wants to, if your design goal is to increase your input resistance, you can add more and more such stages in parallel. You can cascade such stages. So let me add this. Let me say that you have n such stages. So you have n such stages of BJTs. Here all the collectors are at ground, AC ground. If you had n such stages of BJTs and you're going to look into the input terminal here, this is n. So starting from 1, 2, 3 till n, n identical stages, what do you think approximately what will be your input resistance? So will it be beta plus 1 whole power n minus 1? Am I right? It will be beta plus 1 whole power n minus 1 into r pi approximately. You see here, we had two stages. It was r pi here. It was beta plus 1 r pi here. I'm ignoring plus r pi because it's smaller compared to beta plus 1 r pi. It is beta plus 1 r pi here, and here we said it is beta plus 1 whole square. So therefore it is beta power n minus 1 into r pi approximately. I can ignore r pi. R pi is much smaller compared to this term. So this is what you would expect. So which means it's proportional to n. So if I add more number of stages on this axis, if I plot n as the number of stages I'm adding, it just increases exponentially. The input resistance, it will start from r pi and then it will keep increasing exponentially as you increase the number of stages. But do you think that will happen in reality? See, in the last class, I told something, a very interesting result. If you open circuit your emitter and let's say there is a collector resistance of R naught, what is the maximum input resistance possible? What is the maximum input resistance? Emitter is open, RE is infinity. Yes, is that right? It is actually R pi plus beta plus 1 into R naught. And this we approximately said is equal to, I can ignore the first term, is equal to beta times R naught. Okay? Or A naught into R pi. A naught into R pi, which is A naught is nothing but GM into R naught. We said this is the limit. So this is a fundamental limit. no matter how many devices you cascade. Okay, so what's happening in the circuit? Let's look at the circuit. Yeah, here it is, maybe it's R pi, which is fine. The first stage input resistance is R pi. The next stage and so on, let's assume at this stage, it's a very high resistance. The resistance you see here is C. And one thing that you have to keep in mind, at every stage, there is an R naught coming in parallel. At every stage, there is an R naught present. Okay, instead of, at every stage, you will get something like this. Beta plus 1 into N minus 1 R pi parallel R naught. Okay, but you will have some kind of an R naught coming in parallel with it. So even if this term becomes infinity, even if this term becomes extremely large, what will happen is that you will be fundamentally limited by beta R naught. You cannot exceed beta R naught. You guys understood what I said, or you want me to? So let me say, let me go one step ahead. So step by step. So if let's say the first stage here, the resistance here is actually not R pi, but it is actually what? R pi in parallel with R naught. The first stage resistance is R pi parallel R naught. The next stage, I think probably I'll analyze it for three stages. It will be much clearer that way. So here if you see, there is also R naught in parallel here. So there is R pi here and there is R naught. Both of them will appear in parallel. So I can ignore this first stage and replace it by a resistance of value R pi parallel R naught. And the resistance seen here will actually be beta into R pi parallel R naught. That's the resistance because of this stage. Then there is also R naught because of this stage. That whole thing will be in parallel with R naught. So you got it now? Even if R pi and parallel R naught is really large, beta times R pi into R naught in parallel with R naught, it cannot exceed R naught, right? This value will always be less than or equal to R naught. If you have two resistors in parallel, okay, the parallel equivalent of the two resistance will always be smaller than the smallest of the two. So if you have R1 parallel R2, and let's assume R1 is less than R2, then R1 parallel R2 will always be less than R1. It will be equal only if R2 is infinity. Okay, it will always be less than R1. So keeping that in mind, this value can at max be equal to R0. At every stage, you have R0 coming in parallel with the input resistance. So the final stage, it will be, ideally it should be beta plus 1 R0, but I told you guys, I mean, approximate, assume beta is much greater than 1, it is beta R0. So this is the limiting value. You can never exceed this value in a bipolar junction transistor. Okay, so no matter how many devices you cascade, if you think that you're going to get a higher resistance, you will always be less than this. Now, if let's say this is like, so what we discussed, it's ideally supposed to grow exponentially like this. So this is your input resistance. This is the number of stages. This is beta plus 1 whole power n minus 1 R naught. Ideally, it's supposed to increase exponentially like that. But what we are saying right now is that it's going to saturate after a point, and that value is going to be A naught R pi or beta times R naught. So R naught is smaller than practically, or is there a reason behind it? Okay. See, R naught parallel R pi into beta plus 1. See, if you see, generally R pi, if your beta is really large, if your beta, for example, if your beta is really large, around 200 or 100, in that case, R pi will be a really large number. Okay? R pi will be a large number. It will be comparable to R naught. It will be comparable. Okay? I can't directly compare. Let me take some value. For example, let's assume GM R naught is, for some practical reasons, I think let's assume GM R naught is 100 and GM R pi is also beta, which is 100. I'm just assuming a very, very specific example where I've assumed A naught, which is your intrinsic gain, is also 100. This need not be true at all, but I've taken one specific example and I'm assuming J naught R naught is 100 and GM R pi is also 100. If you assume these two to be the values here, your R naught is actually what? A naught by GM. Your R pi is actually beta by GM. Okay? So A naught and beta are really large numbers, so they can be comparable. R pi and R naught can be comparable. So similarly, R pi parallel R naught can also be comparable, maybe half of, if let's say they both are equal, I assume in this example, both of them to be 100. In that case, they'll come out to be approximately, let's say, R naught by 2. Okay? Now you're multiplying that with beta plus 1. Look, this is a really large resistance, right? You're into beta plus 1, beta is like 200 times this. That in parallel with R naught is going to be approximately R naught itself, right? So can you see that? R naught obviously is smaller than R naught by 2 to beta plus 1. So that's what I was trying to tell before. Okay, so you can see what I'm trying to tell you with this analysis is that, of course, adding more number of stages is going to improve your input resistance. But if you exceed this value, so if let's assume that this is the fundamental limit. So after this, for example, after this point, if you see it's starting to flatten out, the gain is starting to, I mean, the improvement in resistance is flattening out. You don't really gain much even if you increase the number of stages. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to come at in this analysis. Okay, fine guys. So this is how you should, I mean, I give one very small example of how you will make engineering decisions. Sometimes later we will see, not the number of stages, but we will later see how to choose bias currents. Will you get any benefit by changing bias currents? And all those points we will discuss. So this is how you make a decision. After a point, if you don't get benefits by changing some quantity, you stop changing it. Is it some specific point where it starts to flatten out? Yeah, you can define it. You can maybe define it, right? So you can, so when your input resistance, probably you can approximately say beta plus 1 power n minus 1 r pi. Okay. When this starts becoming, or rather, when this starts becoming much greater than r naught, okay, then that is the point. After that, the resistance is r naught itself, right? So you can use this condition maybe. Yeah. It's a, I just probably didn't give much thought to that, but you can think of it this way. Got it, right? So these two are in parallel at every stage. At every stage, these two are in parallel. At any given stage, if R naught happens to be much smaller than the input base resistance, then R naught will dominate. That's it. After that, you won't gain much benefits out of it. Okay. So fine. We'll go to the next point. The next point is, I'll just tell you why did I do this analysis right now. I'll just introduce the problem to you, and probably I think I'll finish this discussion what we had yesterday, and then I'll come back to the why did we carry out this analysis. No, why did we think of something like this? I'll come to this discussion again. So there is another result that we discussed in the last class, which is if you had a resistance RS at the base of this and you're looking into the emitter with collector being at ground, what is the resistance seen here? First, ignore R naught. Let's assume R naught is infinity. What is the resistance seen here? Let me call it R in E. R in E is the emitter resistance. What is that value? It was R pi plus RS the whole divided by beta plus 1. Right? Or you can write it as small r e plus RS by beta plus 1. So what we were seeing here, we were seeing a very interesting result. We were seeing that the resistance seen into the emitter is small r e plus whatever is at the base divided by beta plus 1. Okay, that's the result that we have seen in the previous lecture. So now let me pose a question this way. So let's say we have a BJT this way. I have terminated this by a resistance RS. Okay, I have terminated this by a resistance RS. So now I'm asking you to find the emitter resistance at this point, R in E at this point. So how will you do it? So whenever you're given this, go step by step. First, come, let's discuss the first stage. What is the resistance at this point? At this point, it is small r e plus RS by beta plus 1. What is the resistance at this point? So it will again be small r e plus this whole term. This will be small r e plus RS by beta plus 1 the whole square, small r e plus beta plus 1 by beta plus 1. Okay, you have to repeat the same thing again. Now, if you see at this point here, your R in E is going to be small r e plus small r e by beta plus 1 the whole square. This whole term divided by beta plus 1 again. Okay, so you will get by beta plus 1 plus small r e by beta plus 1 the whole square plus r s by beta plus 1 whole cube. Now what will I do? What will I do here is that I'll ignore these two terms, because since you have r e, in comparison to that, these two terms will be much smaller because you're dividing by beta plus 1 and by beta plus 1 whole square. So I'll ignore these two in comparison with r e. Then you get r e plus r s by beta plus 1 whole cube. So now, if I have n such stages, and I've connected RS here, this is AC ground. Let's assume that you have n such stages. What do you think will be the resistance at this point, input resistance? N such, look at this expression and you can generalize it. What do you think will it be? Yes, it will be small r e plus RS by beta plus 1 the whole power n. Okay? It will be Rs by beta plus 1 the whole power n. So it will keep getting divided, right? Rs gets divided by beta plus 1 here, beta plus 1 whole square here, and so on. Finally, it gets divided by beta plus 1 whole power n here. Okay? So this is a very interesting result. So I'll now try to connect both the dots. The first result we derived here, the maximum input resistance, the minimum input resistances, Re plus Rs by beta plus 1. Okay? Now, is there any fundamental limit for R in E, the minimum resistance that you see? Is there any fundamental limit? What do you think will be the fundamental limit? R E itself, right? Small R E itself. Okay? Because at every point, if you see, this is a very low resistance. Okay? At this point, if you see, all these are very low resistance values. Since they are such low resistance points, R naught really doesn't matter, even though it comes in parallel. It's a large resistance coming in parallel with a low resistance, so it really shouldn't matter at every stage. I'm coming from this side. Okay? So R naught by itself will not really matter. So that's why the minimum resistance that you can get out of this is Rn will be R. Okay? So now if I try to plot the input resistance with the number of stages, so understand here there is already a source resistance Rs, which is the series resistance of our internal resistance of its voltage source. Now I'm adding amplifiers this way. Okay? And finally I'm connecting it to some load resistance. What we are plotting here is the output resistance seen by the load resistance. It starts from Rs. Let's assume there were no such stages, it will start from Rs. If there were no amplifier, you're directly connecting the load input to the load. Then the output resistance seen by load will be Rs, and it will exponentially decay down to, because it's Rs by beta plus 1 whole power n plus Re, so it will exponentially decay down to a value of small r. Okay, so that's what this analysis is telling us. But this is the fundamental limit. What you see is Re. Now if you see the output resistance finally, if you design your circuit well enough, if your beta is really large, does your output resistance depend upon Rs? Does it even have any dependence upon Rs? No, right? It has no dependence on Rs. So that's another important point to notice here. The output resistance has no dependence on what you have connected to the source. Now that's the whole idea behind this analysis. So I'll try to explain. If you recall, two lectures ago, we were discussing common collector configuration. In common collector configuration, what is the maximum voltage gain of a common collector configuration? 1, right? The maximum voltage gain of a common collector configuration is 1. You cannot exceed 1. It will always be less than or equal to 1. It will be 1. And we said, in many applications, we don't need gain, but you just need to deliver a voltage. You have a voltage and you want to deliver it to a load resistance. But if your source resistance happens to be really large, then we said it cannot deliver the necessary power to the load and therefore we introduce a circuit called a voltage buffer or a voltage follower. So I'm going to introduce the circuit called a voltage buffer with a gain of 1. The gain is just 1. Okay, what are the ideal requirements for this voltage buffer? The input resistance should be, what will be the ideal input resistance? High, as high as possible or infinity. And the what do you want your output resistance to be? Low or zero. Ideally, you want it to be as low as possible or zero. And we said, so now if you look at this, this whole circuit can be just represented by its Thevenin voltage. And we said that Thevenin voltage will happen to be Vs itself, because since Rn is ideally infinity, so this node voltage will also be Vs, because Rn is infinity, and this node voltage will also be Vs. So open circuit voltage will be Vs. And the output resistance now will be the output resistance of this amplifier. So that's what we said. The output resistance is going to be the output resistance of this amplifier. So now this load resistance is going to see a modified source resistance. Okay, a modified source resistance. I don't care what the value of RS is. RS can be really large. But this amplifier, the buffer which we are introducing, should transform the source impedance to some value that's a very small value, and it should be more or less independent on RS. Then you can deliver a really high power to the load. Okay, as the load demands, you can deliver that power. So the goal of this buffer, the buffer amplifier which we were discussing, is that you want that buffer's input resistance to be as high as possible, output resistance to be as low as possible. Okay, and gain is just 1. And we said a common collector easily satisfies that condition. So let's say I introduce a common collector and a load resistance here, and the amplifier has a finite source resistance. There is a voltage source Vs connected to this. Now, let's say I want to represent Thevenin equivalent of this whole part. I want to represent this whole part by its Thevenin equivalent. Ignore R0 for the time being. What do you think will be the open circuit voltage here? See, I have open circuited this Vs itself, right? Vs itself. Why is that? Because I've open circuited this, the emitter current is zero. If the emitter current is zero, base current is zero. So then this node voltage will also be at Vs. This is at Vs. If this is at Vs, since emitter current is zero, we discussed GMVB is zero, which means VB equals VE. So the emitter voltage here will also be equal to Vs. So the open circuit voltage is Vs. Now we'll find the Thevenin resistance. To find the Thevenin resistance, I'm going to short circuit the voltage source and try to find the resistance seen here, RT. What will be the Thevenin? We just derived it now. Ignore R0. R0, assume it is infinity. What will be the Thevenin resistance? We just derived it, right? What is that? That will be small re plus RS by beta plus 1. Okay? So previously, if I assume that small re is a really small number, the load resistance previously without this amplifier, the load resistance was seeing, RL was actually seeing a source resistance of RS. Now it is seeing a smaller source resistance RE, and also RS is getting divided by beta plus 1. It is seeing a much smaller source resistance. So previously we began with a question saying that what happens if your source resistance is very high? If your source resistance is very high, then I cannot directly connect it to the load resistance, because I will not be able to deliver the power the load demands. But now, if you see, the circuit is now modified, and it looks like a modified source resistance or a transformed source resistance, and that source resistance is actually a much lower value than RS. It's a reduced value of RS. So that's what the circuit is actually doing. It's transforming the impedance. Okay. Just one more point to keep in mind. So I think that should be sufficient. If you understood this point, that's the whole idea behind this. So if a single stage is not able to provide you the sufficient voltage gain, then you might consider adding two. That's like almost like a Darlington configuration. You're just giving a higher beta. Okay, so this is RS here and this is VS here. And let's say we connect this load resistance at this point. So what will be the Thevenin equivalent here? Thevenin equivalent, I'll assume VS itself. Approximately the voltage gain is 1 here. Voltage gain is 1. So VS itself will appear hit there. What will be the source resistance? Modified source resistance seen at this point by the load. It will be small Re plus RS by beta plus 1 whole square. Right? Because there are two stages. RS gets divided by beta plus 1 here. And it gets divided by another beta plus 1 at this point. That's it. It gets divided. So now if you see, this is further diminished. The effect of RS is further diminished. And the load resistance will more or less see a resistance of value small Re. And this small Re is under the designer's control. Small Re is given by the VT upon the quiescent collector current. Okay. So this is your approximately, you know, small Re is 1 by GM, which is approximately equal to this. It's actually alpha by GM. So you'll actually have a factor alpha ideally. But if you assume alpha is close to 1, it's close to VT by ICQ. So as a designer, you can choose the desired collector current, keeping your load resistance in mind. You can choose the collector current from that. Okay, if you want your RE to be smaller than load resistance, then you choose your collector current accordingly. Okay, so that's the whole idea behind the common collector configuration and how impedances transform in the presence of source resistance. So that's what I've done. The analysis I've done here is mainly based on that. And it's mainly for that, to show you that the effect of the source resistance is significantly diminished by adding a common collector configuration. Okay, so we are done with these two. I'll just revisit one final result, which is the result that we have already discussed in the beginning of the lecture, which is I'm looking into the collector terminal and I've connected resistance RE. Okay, this is the resistance. And I said that approximately, of course, I'll first write the exact expression. The exact expression, the collector resistance R in C, was actually equal to R naught, which is the R naught of this device, plus this RE in parallel with R pi. So you have to consider that in parallel with R pi, plus RE in parallel with R pi into GM R naught. So GM R naught is the gain of this stage. Okay, intrinsic gain of this state. So whatever resistance is present at the emitter, that in parallel with R pi, that should get multiplied by GM R naught. So I can call this as A naught. So what you actually see is A naught into RE parallel R pi. That's what you see from a single stage. Now let's do something. Let's do the way that we did for a common collector configurations. So we'll add, let's say I'm going to stack devices like this. I've stacked three devices like this. Okay. Now, if I ask you to find, or let me first stack just two devices and ask you to find the resistance. So let's say I ask you to find the resistance seen at this point. What will it be? What is the small signal resistance of this seen at the collector of this transistor? So you have an NPN transistor. I'm looking into the collector. The emitter is at ground, base is at ground. What is the resistance seen here? R naught, yes, it's R naught. So replace this transistor by R naught itself. Now, if you replace this by R naught, now can you tell me what will be the input resistance? Use this expression that's given here. So can I say it is A naught, which is GM R naught of this device, into R naught parallel R pi? Can I say that? This is the output resistance, right? A naught into R naught parallel R pi. That's the output resistance. Now, let's cascade three such devices. Okay, but before cascading, let me ask you a simpler question. What will happen if I open circuit this node? That is, I'm terminating with an RE of infinity. This is here, RE is infinity. What do you think will be the limiting resistance that you'll see here? Is there a limiting resistance? Will you see infinite resistance there? What will be the limiting resistance that you'll see? No. I've open circuited this node. RE is infinity. A naught R pi, that's right. See, why do you see that? because there is a resistance R pi here present in the circuit to ground. So therefore, what can I say? I can model this resistance R pi here in place of Re. And now I just have to multiply this resistance R pi with A naught. That's it. So the limiting resistance you see is A naught into R pi. Or I can write it also as beta R naught. A naught R pi can also be written as, this is nothing, this is also equal to beta R naught. This is the limiting resistance you can see, limiting resistance value that you will see seen from the connector. Okay, so what did I say? I'll just repeat that again. So I was asking, in case I make Re as infinity, if I make Re as infinity, what will be the maximum input resistance that you will see at the collector terminal? You can directly look at it from the equation itself. This is the expression for, this is your expression for R and C, the maximum input resistance, or rather seen from the collector terminal. I shouldn't use input resistance here, but let's just call it RC. The resistance, equivalent resistance seen at the collector terminal, okay? No, R pi cannot be zero. R pi will be zero only if ICQ, DC current is zero. See, this circuit is already biased with some, I already told you, right? This circuit, we don't show the DC operating point, but it is assumed that it is already biased. R pi cannot be zero, IB can be zero, can be, but here it is not. R pi will not be, sorry, R pi will not be infinity. I'm trying to say that R pi cannot be infinity. Okay, R pi will be infinity only if beta is infinity. Otherwise, R pi by itself cannot be infinity. Okay, if collector current is zero, if it is zero, then base current IB can be zero. IB and RB, IB can be zero, but these are all small signal currents, what I'm talking about. R pi cannot be infinity. R pi depends upon what? Beta by GM, which again depends upon the quiescent collector current. So the quiescent, as long as the circuit is biased with some quiescent operating point, around that incrementally R pi will always be finite. It cannot be infinity. Okay, yeah. So now look at this expression. Here we said, we made, what did we do? This expression here, A naught into Re parallel R pi is the resistance. If I make Re as infinity, if I make Re as infinity here from this expression, you can directly see that this term will reduce to A naught into R pi. Fine. So if I make Re as infinity, then the resistance will reduce to a value of A naught R pi. So for the time being, we'll assume that R pi is infinity and see what happens. So let's assume R pi is infinity. If R pi is infinity, what is the limit, what is the resistance that you can see? I'm looking into the collector, R naught is not infinity. Somehow assume R pi is infinity, beta is infinity, so R pi is infinity. Okay, R pi can be infinity only if beta is infinity. If it is biased to the fixed quiescent current, R pi cannot be infinity. Okay, it can be infinity only if you have some hypothetical device with beta is infinity. Now emitter is not open, I'm just connecting a resistance Re here. What is the resistance seen here? RC. What will be the value of RC? Assume R pi is infinity. Assume R pi is infinity. What will be the resistance seen here? Now you can just look at the expression and say, right, look at this expression here itself and say that, no? R pi is infinity here. You just look at that and can you say that? What will that be? R naught plus Re parallel R pi plus Re parallel R pi into GM R naught. This is what, this was the expression. If R pi is infinity, what is Re parallel R pi? Re itself, right? So if R pi is infinity, you will get R naught plus Re into GM R naught. Okay? Yeah. So I can approximate this to, I'll ignore the first two terms. The third term is obviously larger if R GM Re is larger. Approximate this to Re is going to get multiplied by GM R naught. Re is going to get multiplied by GM R naught, or I can write it as Re into A naught. A naught into Re. So this is the result which holds true if R pi is infinity. Okay? That's, just keep this result in mind. If R pi is infinity, the collector resistance will be A naught, intrinsic gain times smaller, capital, the emitter resistance. So just keep this result in mind, we'll analyze this circuit. Okay. So now you have this circuit and you are supposed to analyze and find the total collector resistance seen here. So we'll go step by step. We'll have a bottom-up approach for this. So we'll start from the bottommost transistor. So that, what is the resistance seen into the collector? That is R naught. So I'll take this transistor, replace it with R naught here. See, assume R pi is infinity here. If R pi is infinity, what is the resistance seen here? Use this previous result, A naught R naught, right? If I have corrected this, it is A naught R e. Previously it was A naught into R e. So I can say it is A naught R naught. So I'll replace this whole transistor by A naught into R naught. Now, what is the value of RC seen here? A naught square R naught. That is the resistance you are seeing. So, which means, in theory, if I keep cascading such devices, so this is a totem pole configuration, you are stacking one device on top of the other. Okay, so you are stacking n such devices. What do you expect the RC to be? If you stack n such devices, it will be a naught power n minus 1 into R naught. This is the output resistance you should expect. Ideally, you should expect this. But is there a limiting value to this? If I include R pi, if I consider R pi will eventually limit this. So if R pi is present, what is the limiting value that you can get out of this? By stacking more and more devices, what will be the maximum resistance that you can get? If R pi is finite, what is the maximum value you can get? I just discussed. No, it can't be R pi. So, A naught R pi. That's right. So, what did we say? The limiting case happens when the resistance connected here is infinity. That's really so large. Okay. Or you can assume that, see, let's assume there is an Re present. When your Re is much greater than R pi, then Re will no longer be in the picture. So your resistance is what? A naught into Re in parallel with R pi. So this will be approximately equal to A naught R pi itself. So the limiting value that you can get by cascading in a totem pole, this is called as a totem pole, one on top of each other. It's a totem pole configuration. Okay. So that will be A naught into R pi. Okay, that will be A naught into R pi. So that, A naught into R pi, or in terms of R naught, it will be beta R naught. So that is the fundamental limit of the resistance that you can get. So similarly, if I try to draw a graph like this, ideally you are expecting the resistance to grow like this, A naught power n minus 1 into R naught. As I stack more and more devices, you are expecting it to go exponentially like this, where the minimum value is R naught, right? If you connect no resistance, if you just have one stage, the minimum resistance is R naught. Now I keep on stacking more and more devices. As I keep on stacking more and more devices, ideally you are expecting it to increase exponentially with the number of stages. So if this is n, okay, it should increase exponentially with the number of stages. Okay, it might have a more sharper profile, but yeah, it should increase exponentially. But what happens here is that after a point, it saturates, and the limiting value is A naught R pi or beta R naught. It starts getting limited. So in a BJT, you cannot get this. That's why this term beta R naught is quite useful, because it tells you the limiting resistance you see from the collector or the base, it can never exceed beta R naught or A naught R pi. Okay, so that's the discussion I wanted to have today. So finally, you got this point, right? So this is the limiting value. So we have discussed three important points. We saw what happens if I have, we actually analyzed the base resistance seen into the base with a finite emitter resistance. Then we analyzed what will be the emitter resistance even in the presence of R naught and all of that. What will be the emitter resistance seen here? And the third case, we analyzed what will be the collector resistance when you terminate the emitter with the resistance RE and bases at ground. Okay, so we know how to analyze all the three cases. We have just derived expressions for all the three cases. Okay, and in the first case, we said it is R pi plus beta plus 1 into RE parallel R naught. So whatever resistance is here, which is RE parallel R naught, gets multiplied with beta plus 1 and R pi gets added to that. Now in this case, the emitter resistance, seen at the emitter, it's actually small RE plus RS, whatever resistance is present at the base, divided by beta plus 1. The whole thing, of course, is in parallel with R naught, but generally R naught will be a very large number, so we can ignore R naught here. It will be RE plus RS of beta plus 1. So whatever is present at the base, it gets divided by beta plus 1. And in this third case, the collector resistance, we said it's going to be A naught into RE, the emitter resistance, in parallel with R pi. So that's what we discussed for all the three stages. Okay, I'll just slightly complicate the third case. What will I do is I'll just like, let's say we just add a base resistance here, some source resistance here. I'm just adding some resistance at this point, and this is say RE here, and this has an intrinsic gain R naught. What do you think will be the collector resistance? Just think about it. We have already analyzed it. It's not difficult. What do you think will be the collector resistance if I just added a finite base resistance? You already have the expressions. But with that, you can very easily say that. So think, how is it affecting R pi? Does RS appear in parallel or series with R pi? Look at it from the small signal point of view. In the base, it is just R pi in series. So the expression remains the same. The collector resistance will be A naught into, previously it was RE parallel R pi. Now it is going to be A naught into RE in parallel with R pi plus RS. That's it. That's the only change. It'll just come in series with it. So in place of R pi, you'll have to just substitute R pi plus RS. This directly follows from the small signal model, and you can already see that. I mean, if previously you had R pi here, which was coming in parallel, but now both will be added in series, and then they both will come in parallel with RE. Fine. So with this, we have more or less discussed everything we need to know about the single stage bipolar junction transistor amplifiers. Okay. One thing I haven't, if you recall in the previous lecture, I just derived a common base amplifier. I said that in a common base amplifier, okay, if you had a load resistance here and then a source resistance was connected here. I did not derive an exact expression for the output resistance of a common base amplifier. R out, I said, was approximately R naught itself. That was derived assuming RS was 0. That result was derived assuming RS was 0. Now, if there is finite R naught, finite RS, can you tell me what will be the value of output resistance now for common base? You're looking into the collector. You're looking into the collector. Okay. And the structure looks very much like this. You have a NPN transistor and a source resistance connected at this. So what is the resistance seen at the collector here? We just derived it, right? So what will be that? You're looking into the collector. It will be A naught into RS parallel R pi, right? Right? GM R naught into RS parallel R pi, or A naught into RS parallel R pi. It's not just RS, it's RS parallel R pi. Yeah. Okay, we just derived it here. It will be A naught into RE parallel R pi, that's the same thing. So that's where these results come in handy. So if you see the collector resistance, or that will happen to be your output resistance of common base configuration. So we have a more exact expression for the output resistance of a common base configuration. I mean, the exact expression should be R naught plus RS parallel R pi plus this term, three terms, That's the exact expression. But I told you more, most of the times, this will be a sufficient. I mean, this is more of more or less a valid expression. Your RS parallel RI gets multiplied by A naught. Okay. One final result which I'll derive. I'll just spend probably a few minutes on this. I think just finish the to conclude the discussion. One final discussion. What will be the emitter resistance if base is at ground? Okay, you're looking into the emitter and collector is at ground. What will be the emitter resistance here? You're looking into the emitter. Small RE parallel R0, is that fine with everyone? So it's actually small RE in parallel with R0. R0, you have, see, first if you can remove R0, if you remove R0, you're looking into the emitter. If you're looking into the emitter and you're applying a voltage Vx across the base emitter, so then the resistance is small RE. I told you if a collector and base are shorted, it is small RE. Now include R0, that's going to come in parallel. So it is small RE in parallel with R0. That's it. Now I will add a resistance at the collector. Okay, now I'm going to add a resistance at the collector. I'll call it RC. So now I'm looking at the emitter. Okay, let's call it RL instead. Let this be RL. I'm looking into the emitter. What do you think will be the resistance? So what I'll do is, I'll give us expression now. I'll try to give an expression now. I'll try to give the intuition in tomorrow's lecture. Okay, mathematically, if you analyze, the expression should look like this. If you're looking at the collector and connected some resistance at the base, okay, some resistance at the base. See, keep in mind, when you're looking here into the emitter, there is already an R pi which is in parallel that you have to always consider. There is an R pi which is in parallel. You're looking into the emitter now. Okay, it will actually be, the result will look approximately like this. It will be RL divided by A naught plus 1 by GM plus small RE. It will actually be plus, let me write it as small RE here. The result you will get is actually small RE plus RL by A naught. Okay, how did we derive that? I will discuss this in the next class. So whatever load resistance is present, that gets divided by the intrinsic gain of this stage. Okay, plus small RE is what you will get as a value for this. I'll discuss this in more detail in the next lecture. Okay, I'll stop at this point. So even if you did not follow the last part, which is entirely fine, I'll discuss this again in the next class. So till this point, we have discussed so far collector, emitter and base resistances. By terminating all the other terminals, one of the other terminals with a finite resistance. And we showed how to derive results for that. Okay, so I'll stop at this point. And if you have any doubts, you can just ask.